the car is, yesterday developed a vibration. Wouldn't really call it a noise yet, but it's a sort of vibration which develops into what's known as the trade of main bearing rumble. Never mind the bearings. Go look at some mummies.
Okay, this is the place. And this is the gentleman who did all the work for it. It does say that they used to use tightly placed cushions around the head to deform the cranium as a sign of ethnic identity and status. Child of the deformed cranium and the cushion on its head. Like I made a bit of a mistake, yeah?
Huh?
I started hablando a máquina. I got stuck in the middle of this river and the river's rising. So I've got to get myself out of it somehow. The engine might just work. It's all rather damp in here. I've got all the valuable things off the floor very quickly. But, I hope I have. Okay. Hello, some smoke coming out of there. Where's that? Turn the ignition off.
Eu tenho winch, se pode usar seu veículo para tirar-me afuera. E aí? Possível, não sei.
Camera's under the passenger seat. It was underwater. Great.
Oh dear. I should have walked it first.
Let's try the distributor cap. See if it'll go again. Seemed to be mobile again. Well, lucky for some Inca remains. Found some horses. Thank you. Well, if you climb your socks off all the way up here, you get a really nice view. There's an Inca village. Not a vast amount to see. Ah, maybe this is the remains of one of those grinding stones. Saw one in the museum. And this is the way down again. Very reminiscent of being at Great Zimbabwe. Shit, there's none of this at Great Zimbabwe. Wow. Amazing what you find when you're out for a stroll. Well, human bones, well dried. Anything more up there? Can't see anything else. Feel out to whisper, really. It's a relatively large green bush with a notice board. Which says, "Dame agua, por favor." Well, alright then. I will. You get big geezers and little geezers. One last shot of these geysers. I got a bit of a headache. It's about just over 15,000 feet here. I think I've got a bit of altitude sickness. Found this swimming pool, which is empty half an hour ago. Went back to the car for my towel. Got collared by a couple of guys who wanted to buy some petrol and chat. Half an hour later, the swimming pool's full. So, hey ho down more horrible roads to Kalama. See you later. Well, I was just leaving and spotted this thing. So I thought I'd come and see what it is. Well, the best that can be said about this is that it's a piece of seriously post-Inca industrial archaeology. Close to see if it's got any bits that say made in Leeds. Where's the switch? On off, let's turn it and see what happens. Oh, it moves. Whoops, what's this? Whoa. Interesting looking red liquid. Well, well. Water just meets the eye. Feels and tastes a bit like brake fluid. I think that'll do. Something about curiosity and cats, I feel. My opinion on that liquid has changed to antifreeze, for what it's worth. Lots of evidence of people getting stuck around here. I'm trying to find a new way across this little stream, so I don't get me nice trainers all muddy again. What do you mean they're not nice? Cost me £7 a piece in Santiago. This looks possible. Get out of puff just walking about round here. Whoa, mud again. And more I expect. Bloody hell. It looked good from a distance. I bet that's not solid. Well, I've just made an exceedingly large error by flogging fuel to those two guys. I'd forgotten that I'd changed tanks yesterday before one was empty, because one was over full and was leaking. That means I've got about half a tank left. Basically what I flogged to those guys was what was going to get me to Kalama. So, I think I'm going to go back to the road to Pedro, San Pedro. I haven't gone far from the geysers, but there's a lot more traffic on that road, and San Pedro has fuel and it's nearer. Let's see how we go. Well, aren't we wrapped up well for winter? Lama and I think Guanaco. Or is it one of these? What do you reckon? That's an alpaca. What it thinks it is. Keep still, camera. Seems to be a large hole here. Too deep to see down the bottom. If you can see. I'm certainly not leaning over there. So, it's that deep. And over here, which is the reason I stopped on the Pan American Highway north, is what they call a historic monument. And there's a thingy, off a whatnot. Nitrate mine office. There's a lot of those around here. Another historic monument. And I'm just about to set off. And I find that some desert rats have been nibbling my tire in the night. So the first job is to blow it up and see if it stays up for a bit. It should stay for a reeker, I think, but I'll fix it there. Ah. foot pump that doesn't like going for a bath. It got soaked in the river as well. Something else to fix, like now.
I've just stopped in the desert where a bridge crosses a sort of river. Very interesting array of vegetation. Are they horsetails or something? I seem to remember these from Botany of Early Plants. Got a bit of a wobble, this bridge. Maybe it's built that way to withstand earthquakes.
Onwards and northwards, whizzing past Iquique. To Arica, which is where I am at the moment. I've just spent 2 or 3 days with a very nice family, knocking about on the beach with them, getting sunburned, welding the car's exhaust pipe again, fixing a puncture, and generally relaxing. Tomorrow I pick up Lydia from the airport. Beginning, I was very keen that she should be able to travel with me. As time went on, my feelings changed in this respect, and by the time of Christmas, I was ready to leave on my own. I've been travelling since Santiago. However, she has her own holiday plans, which include meeting me at Arica Airport tomorrow morning at 11:30. We shall have a look at Bolivia together. Vamos a ver, as they say in these parts.
Good morning. This is halfway between Arica and the Bolivian boundary. Got the tent up, held down by rocks, 10 pegs of no chance on this ground. Part of the Inca Road, and travellers would come here to get food, which would be brought by people of the area who had to give a part of their produce to the king. And food from here is redistributed, was redistributed, to other people, including travellers. These tambos only have tiny little doors so the food can be kept safe inside. Well, the rain has come. I think we're going to see a lot more of this. And the cholera warning. Two minutes later, more trouble on this road. Car transporter gone over the edge. That's your lot, it's raining, the camera's getting wet. This is the village of Putre, a lot of it kept in the same condition as it was when it was started in the 1600s. As we are climbing up in the thin air, between 12 and 13,000 feet here, the car's struggling a little, and the weather's changing a lot. Fine mixture of rain and hail here. Remembering where the car used to leak. And there's ice on the road.
deep, but it's first gear. Changed that tyre, which finally went flat. We're coming into Parinacote. And here are several members of the camel family belonging to the village. These alpacas have distinctive decorations on the ears. Depending on who they belong to. More geezers, perhaps? Hmm? Or just plain porridge? Well, we're travelling east again. From Arica to the border. Hang on, you might ask, you did that before. Quite true. We got to the border, but I was a day late on my vehicle document. I couldn't do anything there, and they sent us back to Arica. So here we are again, about halfway there. Yeah, it's getting very thin already. Really out of puff just climbing up this bit of a hill. I have to take deep breaths every now and again. When you get to the top, it's a lot worse. Almost gasping, it's 4,600 meters there. Bars of silver, by the looks of things. And now it's our turn. those truck drivers are the ones that pulled us out. But not with their trucks. They did it by hand. All the stories of Bolivian truck drivers charging $500 to get you out of trouble seem like a load of crap. This is the German couple we've been travelling with today.
Out of water, I'm going to filter some water.
Hopefully, on this bigger road, where there's some machinery working, it may be a bit better. But we've still got two rivers to cross. The road's gone bad again. We've got some choices to make. There's a road further over to the left. But that wagon is anything to go by. It doesn't look promising. And more wagons may be stuck over there. So we have to do some investigation.
Yeah.
Gracias.
Yeah.
Okay, this river we have to cross with a tow.
Para que no te entre mucha agua y que un poquito hondo. No está tan hondo.
That is going slowly. It's the end of my brakes from now on, I think. Okay, here we go. Down a bit. My feet aren't wet yet. It actually doesn't look that deep. The next bit like. Ooh. Very muddy, very deep mud. Come inside. The thing is, we keep going, which is beautiful. I think there's a bit more. This is magic. What's it like over there? Oh, getting a bit close, but no brakes, so there's nothing I can do. That's the way to do it.
No, it went down completely, then it was sitting.
Yeah. And 10 minutes later. We have a funny noise coming from a wheel. I had one look around it. I can't see anything. Well, there's obviously something going on. So when the road's a bit wider, I shall stop and have a look. Well, I've never seen that before. A seriously dead wheel here. I guess we'd better change it. Well, after changing the wheel, we now found this river. Which is very cold and quite deep. And Helmut is finding some rocks. The truck that towed us through before is behind us. So we have to try him again in a minute when he turns up. We passed him recently. Yeah, hopefully comes our salvation.
Otra vez, por favor.
Yep.
Gracias.
The rocks in the middle are bad. I've got to try and keep to the right-hand side if I can. Coming in here, and both back side doors are open. Look, we're out. And through. And the engine still sort of goes. Strange formations in the desert. I looked in one and found some bones. I'm going to look in the others. Amazing rock shapes around here. Here's one with a small entrance. All guarded by small cacti. Let's see if we can get in. The rock looks a bit loose there. Be careful of that. A bit of a head. What's that? Top part of a skull, I think. Rib bone, part of a femur, all sorts. Ow, more cactus, more bones. Well, I think I should leave them there. Out before I join it.
Thank you.
I guess we're going to be on some program or other this afternoon.
There's the researcher, I think. We'll see what comes out of this. Well, that little fellow lives here. We've just spent one night. We're well above La Paz at about 5,000 meters, and it's telling on us. Last night we tried to drive up this road here. The engine was happy doing it. The petrol pump, I presume for reasons of air pressure, or lack of, couldn't supply petrol quick enough. So if the petrol pump won't do it, maybe this system will. Very shortly we're going to fill that with petrol and see how it goes. Takes the wind out of you. On top of that, I've had diarrhea all morning. Possibly due to the fact that last night we tried cooking brown rice. We boiled it for an hour and it still came out with the texture of buckshot. Being hungry, we ate that and some other veggies. I think I've received no value at all from that meal. The only difference around here is this stuff. And it's not King's red labelled tea. It's leaves of coca. You can make them into tea, which I don't think is that effective. Or you can just chew them like this. Pull off the spine. Everybody around here, La Paz, rest of Bolivia, exists on this stuff. And it does make a difference. Not a vast difference, you still need the oxygen, of which there is very little, but it does perk you up a bit and give you a bit of energy. So I'm whacking some of this down before we pack up camp and try that hill again with a new gadget.
Well, if we thought we were high before, we've come up another 300 metres. And this is the highest ski run in the world. 5,300 metres. So I think anybody with skis is well advised to walk up. If this cable's anything to go by. See what it looks like from the top. You got mountains from 17,000 feet here. You got Lake Titicaca. And if the battery doesn't run out too soon, you've got La Paz. Sun glinting on the upper part, known as El Alto. and one or two lights coming on in the lower big city part. Technology station. And those little fellas, picking up good or bad vibrations. This is the road that we came up. Forgive the puffing and panting. Moggy didn't need his bottle. And I opened the... the bonnet. To fit it, it growled at me and said, "Try cleaning me fuel filters, you silly bugger, then see what I can do." So I did. And it scooted up there in first gear, no trouble at all. And now it's got to scoot back down again. Before it gets dark. So night, night, everybody. Night, night. Well, the brake shoes didn't arrive in time. The rain got here first. So I've got to do it like this. Right next door to Lake Titicaca. But this is one character I certainly didn't expect to find here, along with all his mates. Because we're parked outside the Britannia pub. And if we go through the double doors, as you'd expect to find in a British pub, with the leaded lights and all, you come into a place that does not smack of Bolivia. This is Tom Clough from Bury in Lancashire. Dueño de la casa. And his wife Teresa, behind the bar at the moment. And a very fine bar it is too. But I was hunting for in Bahia Inglesa, not that far north of Santiago. And the rascal wasn't there. And we've turned him up here. I don't know how many thousand miles further north. And a very pleasant place it is to be. Tiquina. Lake Titicaca. We came down that road. And then made that ferry crossing about half an hour ago. Terracing round here is made by the Incas, and this area was much more densely populated Some of it's now being used again. There's a lot of trout about. Right, off we go to Copacabana and into Peru. Bye-bye, Bolivia.
That is a big moth.
Well, we've been whipping along past the side of Lake Titicaca. We're in Peru now. Rushing along to Cusco. And this is one river that we won't be trying to cross. But something rather nasty has happened to the bridge. So unless you're on foot or bicycle, or you're a railway train, you have to go another way. Which is just what we're going to do. Well, this is part of the diversion, and we've come across a small bus stuck in the way. So I'm going to see if this little winch of ours will pull him out. Him out. It's about three more to come through yet, and then we've got to go through the other way, which could be very interesting. Proceeded last night without getting stuck. Came to a place called Ayaviri. We were warned that the next 18 kilometers to Santa Rosa were fairly bad. And indeed they are. This is a bad patch. At the moment, the two bits of metal I had for pulling out bent in half, but the railway line doesn't seem to bend, so we use that for towing ourselves out. And now we tend to proceed in this manner. It's 9:20, we're told there's no trains till midday. We shall see. If they're dropping the passengers off first, it looks like there's a bad bit coming up. They've just passed it. Now it's our turn.
out at last. And after all that, here comes a truck that could have pulled us through in 2 minutes.
We've abandoned the car for a day or two. In a safe garage, of course. Because from Cusco to Machu Picchu, there is no road. Train is the only way to do it. So at 6:20 in the morning, that's what we're doing.
Flies off to Lima and Santiago.
Buen dia, Roberto.
Yeah.
Buen dia. ¿Dónde va?
A la oficina.
Hasta luego. Hola, buen dia.
Okay, this is my last day in Cusco. I've been here in this muddy yard for nearly a week, fixing various things on the car, putting the sump back together, stone guard, changing a wheel bearing. Turning the rear brake shoes upside down to get more wear out of them. And I'm sorting myself out at the moment. A little bracket on the car to do tracking shots. So, with a bit of luck, we'll see the results of that later today. There's a brilliant mural in the main road, about 50 meters long. That's the only way I can film it.
Ciao Roberto, muchas gracias. Ciao,
fuerte. Va bien.
Gracias. Ciao. Ciao, amigo.
Hola, señor de Basket.
¿Cómo estás?
Bien, bien. Bien, provecho.
It's 8 o'clock. We're scampering along this beautiful piece of Pan American Highway, just short of Nazca, trying to get to see the lines before the sun flattens them out completely.
That's the way to really see these lines, but I didn't have my 4 and 6 pence spare, so I have to make do with this.
This is puncture mending time, 100 kilometers south of Lima. And we've got a few apprentices. Looking like hard work. Camera got nicked after I got to Lima. But anyway, I continued up through Ecuador into Colombia and Bogota and met Lydia, who came up from Chile. We took the car down to Cartagena, checked out fortifications that the Spanish used to try and keep the British from nicking the gold that they'd nicked from the Incas, and had a quick look at their Spanish Inquisition situation. After 40 days there, we found a boat to take ourselves and the car over to Panama, and saw some flying fish on the way. And in Central America, we found some strange looking fruit. Might look like a pepper, or even a funny shaped tomato, but you try eating that and it'll put blisters on your lips. But hanging underneath it, you can just about see a cashew nut. And that's how you get them. And one of the tires caught a terminal disease. We were offered other strange things to eat, and found that the car had not lost its popularity. In Guatemala, I used the winch to pull the engine out of somebody's car that I was fixing, and we carried on from there through Belize and into Mexico. Here you can see me gathering meteorites in the Valley of Silence near Durango. We came into the States at El Paso and went west via Grand Canyon and Death Valley to San Francisco. Then we went further north and, having picked the wrong time of year, skidded our way across the continent from west to east, sometimes finding somewhere to sleep, or doing the best we could with our weekend tent. But whenever we came across them, we always received great hospitality from Native Americans. The guy in the white hat is a Cheyenne, Leonard Wolfblack, whose great-great-grandfather fought against Custer, and very proud he was too, that their people paid for that later. We carried on to New York and the statue of, I forget now. Then north again, spending 2 days changing the clutch in somebody's backyard. Then up to Canada and Newfoundland. This is up in the north, all over Newfoundland, until we found ourselves a boat that could take us, and the car back to Liverpool, where we arrived in September 1997. So, if you want a car to take you around the world, look no further.